lazy concept based learning. So this is the first lesion of the fibro-osseous lesion series that we are covering, and the lesion is fibrous dysplasia, a very very important fibro-osseous lesion. This lesion was known by different names like Lichtenstein and Jaffe disease, because in 1942 it was described by these two authors in detail. It is also known by Freud as osteitis fibrosa localizata or disseminata, depending on how many bones are involved, that is if either it is monoosteotic or polyosteotic. And Jacobson called it fibrous dystrophy. So these names you can remember, BDS students, it's their choice, but I feel those who are preparing for MDS or those who are currently studying MDS, they should know about these other names. Okay. So what is fibrous dysplasia? Fibrous dysplasia, when someone says, personally, three words come to my mind. They are, it's a benign skeletal disorder. Benign skeletal disorder. It's self-limiting. And it is slow growing. You can't forget these three features, and you can't miss these three features either clinically or when you're writing in your exam, right? So what happens in fibrous dysplasia is that the normal bone, there is the bone resorption process that happens is very normal. So just like a normal process, bone gets resorbed. But what replaces this bone is not a healthy or a mature bone. Okay, what replaces this is a woven bone, not a very mature, immature bone. Okay, woven bone is nothing but immature bone. So normal bony resorption followed by abnormal proliferation of the fibro-osseous tissue. Abnormal proliferation of fibro-osseous tissue. So all the clinical features, everything that you see in fibrous dysplasia revolves around this only. Okay? That is abnormal proliferation of fibro-osseous tissue. Coming to the types of fibrous dysplasia, there are three main types of fibrous dysplasia depending on which bones and how many bones are involved. They are classified or divided into three types. Monoosteotic, if a single bone is involved. Polyosteotic, if the fibrous dysplasia is widespread and involves multiple bones. And third is craniofacial. Craniofacial type is when only craniofacial bones are involved. So that, okay, one important thing here, that doesn't mean that craniofacial bones are not involved in monoosteotic and polyosteotic types. In fact, 50 to 100% of the cases of polyosteotic fibrous dysplasia involves cranial bones, craniofacial bones. But along with this, other bones including the limbs are involved. Okay? Monoosteotic also, a relatively few number, only 10 to 15% of the cases will show craniofacial involvement. But craniofacial, you classify it only when craniofacial bones are involved. I think that's pretty obvious by the name itself. Only craniofacial bones are involved. So moving on to the clinical features. So first we discuss about the age that is commonly affected. Fibrous dysplasia is a disease of teens or adolescents. So, by the time of cases of fibrous dysplasia are diagnosed, the age is around 20 years. Okay, so early teens and adolescents are most commonly involved. Adolescent. Then, coming to the gender. Gender is different for different types. For monoostotic, it's an equal gender predilection. Males and females are equally involved in monoostotic type, whereas females are slightly more commonly affected than males in polyostotic type. Coming to the clinical presentation, pain is a constant feature of fibrous dysplasia. So, patient will generally complain of pain in the affected area. Along with pain, pathological fractures is also commonly noticed, because what is the reason? Abnormal proliferation of fibrous tissues. So, clinical presentation will include pain plus pathological fracture, because the bone is not mature enough. Okay. Next, one very important diagnostic feature is the swelling, which is present along with this fibrous dysplasia, is always unilateral and it does not cross the suture line. It doesn't cross the suture length. One interesting finding regarding the pain is that females complain excessive pain or increase in the pain, especially when they are pregnant or during their menstrual cycle. So what is the reason behind that? Increase in the pain during menstrual cycle and pregnancy. The reason is definitely hormonal. Okay. Just let me erase this. So what happens in pregnancy or when the woman is in her menses is that hormones, estrogen hormone is excessively produced. There is increase in the estrogen hormone. So how is this related to fibrous dysplasia? There are estrogen receptors found in fibrous dysplasia. Okay. So that is the reason that in fibrous dysplasia. So that is the reason there is increase in the pain during these hormonal changes, that is pregnancy and menstrual cycle. A syndrome which is associated with fibrous dysplasia is McCune-Albright syndrome. This syndrome is a triad of polyostotic fibrous dysplasia, Caffé Olé spots or macules, Caffé Olé spots, and endocrinal disturbances. So polyostotic fibrous dysplasia, we have seen what it is. What are Caffé Olé spots? Caffé Olé spots, or otherwise called as Caffé Olé macules, are nothing but round or to ovoid shaped pigmentation. Okay, these are depending on the individual. If he is fair, the pigmentation is a little browner. And if the individual is darker, then the staining is, or the pigmentation is a little darker. But these are round to oval shaped pigmentation that you see in certain diseases. Okay. Caffé Olé spots actually literally translate as coffee with milk, because the color is similar to the pigmentation that we see here. Okay. So these Caffé Olé spots, there is some important description. Okay, these spots in fibrous dysplasia, that is in McCune-Albright syndrome, they occur ipsilaterally, that is only on the single side. They do not cross the midline. And they are generally seen in the trunk area. Okay, and very, very important part. The borders of these spots are irregular. irregular borders. Why am I stressing on this is, caffeole spots are also seen in a disease called as neurofibromatosis type 1. Neurofibromatosis type 1. And you need to differentiate the caffeole spots which occurs in this disease from McCune-Albright syndrome. And the difference is, the borders are irregular in fibrous dysplasia, whereas in neurofibromatosis, the borders are more regular. Regular borders, you see. It has been, actually the borders have been compared to the coast of Maine and coast of California. Another very, very important MCQ for students preparing for MBS. Irregular borders is compared to the coast of Maine, because that is a bit irregular, coast of Maine, and it is seen in fibrous dysplasia. Whereas regular borders, caffeole spots, which is seen in neurofibromatosis, is compared to coast of California, which is a bit regular, coast of California. Okay, so this is important and should be remembered. Moving on to the endocrinal disturbances. These endocrinal disturbances are due to the hyperactivity of the endocrine cells, and that can manifest either as precocious puberty, especially in females, then hyperthyroidism. Hyper, why? Because as I said, it is due to the hyperactivity of the endocrine cells, okay, or pituitary adenoma. Pituitary gland can also be affected. Pituitary adenoma is nothing but a benign tumor of the pituitary gland. Okay, here let me add one note kind of thing, which most of you must be knowing, but then for those of you who don't know this, it's easy to remember. Whenever, see, adenoma or pituitary adenoma, when I say, anyway, when you describe a benign tumor or a malignant tumor, the word oma is added as a suffix to describe a tumor, okay, and this oma is added to describe a benign tumor. Okay, so fibroma, adenoma, leiomyoma, rhabdomyoma, anything, odontoma, ameloblastoma, all these are benign tumors. Okay, when it is malignant, always the word either carcinoma or sarcoma will be the suffix. Carcinoma or sarcoma. Carcinoma if it is an epithelial malignant tumor, sarcoma if it is a connective tissue malignant tumor. Okay, so pituitary adenoma is a benign tumor because it has only adenoma. If it were malignant, it would have been pituitary adenocarcinoma. Okay, because adeno is nothing but gland, any gland, salivary gland, or in this case pituitary gland. Okay, so even in salivary gland tumors, all those adenomas that you must have read, whenever the word adeno is used, it means salivary gland. Oh, sorry, it means gland, any type of gland. Okay, coming back to fibrous dysplasia, this is the important syndrome which is associated, that is McCune-Albright syndrome. Now, having done with the clinical presentation and the syndrome, let us move on to the pathogenesis of fibrous dysplasia. Again, very, very important. The gene which is mutated in fibrous dysplasia is well known, and that gene is NAS1 gene, which is guanine nucleotide binding protein alpha stimulating activity polypeptide. Quite a big name. So NAS1 gene is mutated in fibrous dysplasia. So this has been mutated. So this, when this gene, mutated gene, is activated, it leads to the activation of adenyl cyclase, and that in turn leads to persistent increase in the cyclic AMP or CAMP. Increase in the cyclic AMP, adenosine monophosphate. Now this increase is persistent, a keyword here. So there is a persistent increase in the CAMP. This increase elevation of CAMP will lead to the stimulation of the endocrine receptors, and that stimulation will lead to the abnormal expression of some important genes, target genes, which is CFOS. So there is an abnormal expression of CFOS gene. Now why this gene is important is the progeny of this gene are three main cells: osteoblast, melanocyte and endocrine cells. Okay. So the hyperactivity of osteoblast will lead to fibrous dysplasia. Then the hyperactivity of melanocytes will lead to the pigmentation that we see as cafe au lait spots. And the hyperactivity of endocrine cells will lead to the endocrine disturbances that we have seen, like precocious puberty or pituitary adenoma, hyperthyroidism and others. Okay. So now you can correlate the clinical characteristics that we have discussed and the pathogenesis. So how all these cells are getting affected, and what if these cells are getting affected, what they are ultimately causing. Okay. So if osteoblast is getting affected, it can lead to polyosteotic or monoosteotic fibrous dysplasia, depending on what I'll discuss in the next few seconds. Melanocyte, if it is affected, then McCune-Albright syndrome, which includes cafe au lait spots and endocrine disturbances. Now, the mutation of this gene, NAS1 gene, is occurring in all the types of fibrous dysplasia. But the clinical severity depends on at which stage is this gene getting mutated. So, what I mean to say is, if this gene gets mutated in the early embryonic stage, that is within 6 weeks of intrauterine life, then what happens? Then it shows a completely different picture. Or if it gets mutated at the late embryogenesis, that is after 6 weeks of intrauterine life till the birth. Or is the gene getting mutated postnatally, that is after birth? Early embryo is within 6 weeks and late embryo is after 6 weeks. So now, using logic, if the early this gene gets mutated, the more cells are going to get affected, correct? Because the more cells are still in undifferentiated state in the early stages. And as the time increases, or as the time goes and the everything is over, the embryogenesis is over and the complete development is over and the baby is born, then most of the cells are differentiated and sorted. So less number of features or less number of cells are going to get affected. So similarly, if the NAS1 gene is mutated in the early embryonic stage, then all the three progenitor cells are affected. That is, osteoblast, melanocyte, endocrine cells. All these are affected. So that will lead to which syndrome? McCune-Albright syndrome. Right? Now, if the gene is mutated in the late embryogenic stage, then what happens is the progenitor cells, less of the progeny is affected. So in this case, only the osteoblast is affected, but that osteoblast has still to disperse in various locations. So as a result, that affected osteoblast, when it gives rise to a lot of bones in other places, you see polyosteotic fibrous dysplasia. Because still so many bones have to be formed and the gene is mutated before that. So as a result, more of the bones are affected with this disease. Now, no points for guessing. If the gene is mutated postnatally, that is after birth, then only it is localized to a single bone. So that will form monoosteotic fibrous dysplasia. Clear? I hope I haven't confused you. For those who want a recap, let me just recapitulate whatever I've said. So, the pathogenesis of fibrooosteous lesion is because of the basis is the mutation of the NAS1 gene, guanine nucleotide binding protein, alpha stimulating activity polypeptide. This mutation will lead to the activation of adenyl cyclase. This adenyl cyclase will in turn lead to persistent increase in the CAMP, that is cyclic adenosine monophosphate. This persistent increase in CAMP will lead to the abnormal expression of the proto-oncogene CFOS, which is responsible for the differentiation of different progenitor cells, osteoblast, melanocytes, endocrine cells. So, if the osteoblasts are affected, fibrous dysplasia results in the individual. Hyperactivity of melanocyte will result in formation of caffé olive spots. And when endocrine cells are hyperactivated, it will lead to various endocrine disturbances. Now, this is about the comprehensive fibrous dysplasia. Now, whatever we had discussed, the different clinical picture or the different types of fibrous dysplasia, that occurs depending on which stage is the gene mutated. So here, if it is mutated in the early embryogenesis, that is within 6 weeks, then still all these cells are yet to be differentiated. So all these cells are involved, leading to McEwen-Albright syndrome. If it is occurring, the mutation occurs after 6 weeks, before birth, that is the late embryogenesis period, then only the osteoblast is affected, but multiple bones are affected, so leading to polyosteotic fibrous dysplasia. If the mutation occurs after birth, the disease is less severe. It's just involving a localized single bone, causing monoosteotic fibrous dysplasia. Clear? So, in this video, I'll just end the video here. And the fibrous dysplasia will be continued in the following video. Thanks for watching.